Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Today is Sunday, December 4th. It's Communion Sunday at Consuming Fire Teaching and Deliverance Ministries. And we're glad to have you with us. Today we're talking about, as every Communion Sunday, we're going to be talking about that cross and what it did. We had our praise and worship already, and I was just telling the people how important it is and how, oh my God, how blessed I am right now. I'm so blessed. Hallelujah. We started out with the opening scripture. The deacon started out with Jeremiah 33 about call on your maker. Your maker. He wants to show you things you didn't know. There's so much that we don't know that God desperately wants to show us. Amen. Then our first song, it was a high beat song. Jesus is mine. Everywhere I go, everywhere I be. Amen. And that's true. Once you get the Lord as your Lord and Savior, he said he will never leave you and never forsake you. I don't care what's going on. Your mother and your father may forsake you. It's true. I'm your grandmother. I'm looking at Brittany. I'm your grandma. But one of these days, I'm going to heaven. I'm going to have to forsake you, God. I love you. I'm going to have to go one of these days. But guess who will never leave you, forsake you? When I leave, he's still going to be with you. Amen. So that song, that first song, Jesus is mine. Everywhere I go, when I go down to food court, everywhere I go, when I go over to Kaiser, Jesus is mine. When they try to persecute me, Jesus is mine. I'm telling you, these worship songs ain't nothing but the word in song. That's all. Hallelujah. And then the next one, was you there when they crucified my Lord? He was crucified for us. And she said just the thought of him being crucified. That was one of the opera singers back in the day. Just the thought of him and the way he was crucified. In fact, we had that last communion. Have you considered the things that Jesus went on that cross? She said it makes her want to tremble, what he went through for us. She said, it makes me want to tremble. And then the Lord said, remember me. So let me tell you, whenever you're tempted to sin, remember what he did. He said, remember me. Make a choice that you won't crucify him no more with your sins. Why would we crucify him all over again and make him suffer? Because every time we sin, the heart of Christ suffers. It hurts him. So when she said, were you there when they crucified my Lord? No, none of us were there over 2,000 years ago. But will you crucify him all over again by worshiping the devil? Don't do it. Amen. These songs are deep. Hallelujah. And then it said, we played that song, Hallowed Be Thy Name. Beautiful song. And the truth is, yes, hallelujah, hallowed be thy name. What does that mean? That he is worthy of the highest honor. Our maker, God Almighty, they sung that song. They sung that song to God Almighty. The scripture started with thy maker. A lot of people don't understand that your maker, your creator, God Almighty, is Jesus Christ. He's Jesus Christ. Amen. Today we'll get a lesson on how it took God to come down from heaven to save us. God himself. No human blood could do it. Today people lift up this man and that man. I'm telling you, ain't no man worthy. It couldn't be done by man. It took our maker. So always remember that in the mighty name of Jesus. And then that blood, that last song. My God. I like this one. I like this song. I like all the songs about the blood. But most of them say, you wash me white as snow, which could offend some people. I need to be made white. So I try not to play that. But this Matt Redman one, he says, you wash me pure as snow. That's what it means. So see, because the devil uses those kind of things, white is good and dark is wrong. So I don't want to use those songs, even though the blood part I like, but I don't want to cut any of it out. He washed us, talking about all of us, human beings, pure as snow through the blood. Kind of human blood. These men, they lifting up in these religions. Kind of human blood could do that, could wash us pure as snow. What kind of blood can make us the friends of God? Nothing. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing but the blood. Nothing can change us. But you can follow all the rules. You can lift up Muhammad, Buddha, whoever, Hare Krishna. You can lift them up. But they just a mere man or woman that needs to be washed pure as snow, that needs to be made the friends of God by the blood of Jesus. Oh, yeah, this is Communion Sunday. And I can't wait till every first Sunday, but I can talk about that cross some more. Hallelujah. Y'all got your lessons. Hallelujah. I can't holler. Wait till Communion Sunday. And actually, we talk about it every day, but we focus in on it on Communion Sunday. Amen. Hallelujah. So we're going to get to the Word of God, and we're going to do some PowerPoint, and you guys know how I teach. I'm going to pop off the PowerPoint when I get excited or inspired. So we're going to go there now to our PowerPoint and teach about the cross. Hallelujah. How appropriate to teach about the cross on Communion Sunday. Praise God. So your first scripture comes out of 1 Corinthians 1:18. It says, "For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God." For the preaching of the cross, that doesn't go fully. I just took excerpts out of there. The preaching of the cross to people that's perishing, to people that's going to hell, what we're preaching today, this is straight out foolishness to them. Straight out foolishness. But to us which are saved, which know what God done, is the power of God. And for that we rejoice. Hallelujah. And we pray for those that don't know, that they could come on in, that God would open their eyes to that maker. Your maker, Jeremiah said, "I'm your maker. Call unto me and I will show you things you don't know." See, that's one of the things that people don't understand. That cross, I'm talking about a lot of Christians too. They don't understand what happened at that cross. Amen. In 7,426 ritual washings for consecrations, purifications, and sacrifices for sin have been noted in the Old Testament. Let me say that again. 7,426 ritual washings for consecrations, purifications, and sacrifices for sin have been noted in the Old Testament. And could none of it consecrate, purify, or use as a proper sacrifice? None of it. But this man, talking about Jesus Christ, after he offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down on the right hand of God, from henceforth expecting till his enemies be made his footstool. And I'm going to tell you what that means a little later. So there was in the Old Testament, I'm going to say it a third time, because I want you to get this. So when you get this, you understand what one act of God did, what 7,426 washings and consecrations in the Old Testament couldn't do. They couldn't do it. One act on the cross did it. One act on the cross did it. Amen. For by one offering, look at this, he has perfected forever them that are sanctified. For by one offering, not 7,426 things, one offering, he has perfected forever them that are sanctified. That's what the blood does. It ain't because we do so much. I'm the greatest Christian. I pray more than you. I do. It's the blood. It's the blood. It is nothing but the blood. Get yourself up under the blood. Learn who your maker is and worship him and praise his holy name. Here's what he said. This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws into their hearts and in their minds will I write them. You have to be born from above. Nothing can do that but the blood of Jesus. Muhammad can't do that. Hare Krishna can't do that. Buddha can't do that. You can't do it. Only the blood. In order to be born from above, nothing but the blood. And you have to be born from above to be seated from above. And to be seated from above, you have to be to get a perspective from above. See, what we come into the world today, let me come off of PowerPoint. Praise God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Stop to share. Hallelujah. What we come into you from today is what only the blood of Jesus could do. Let me read again what was on the PowerPoint. You have to be born from above to be seated from above to have a perspective from above. That's why if you're not born again, the preaching of the cross is foolishness to you because you're not born from above. And in order, once you're born from above, Christ sits you in heavenly places above. And then you get a different perspective about the truth. A wonderful thing. So let us go to John 3:3 through 6, 1 Peter 1 and 3. John 3, turn with me in your Bibles to John 3. Let's look at, we've heard this again and again. You must be born again in order to enter into the kingdom of heaven, which is the moment you, with a sincere heart, receive Jesus Christ. You're born again immediately into the kingdom. You don't have to wait to get to heaven to get into the kingdom. You do it, I taught on it last week. You do it by the confessing, believing in your heart, the gospel, and then confessing with your mouth, and then you're born again. So in John 3:3 through 6, it says, Jesus answered and said unto him, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. In other words, he cannot have a perspective that is from above. His perspective is only here on the earth. So the preaching of the cross is foolishness to those whose perspective is only on the earth. Amen. Then 4, Nicodemus said unto him, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Verse 5, Jesus answered, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That water is your first birth. You got to be born the first time to be born again. And then that goes down and explains it a little more in 6. That which is born of the flesh, your first birth, is flesh. And that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. So you already born from down here when you were in your mother's sack of waters. Amen. You was born and then you was flesh. But in order to be born from above, you have to be born of the Spirit again. Amen. Go to 1 Peter 1 and 3. 1 Peter 1 and 3. I hope y'all writing your scriptures down, although it will be in the video if you watch the video. You know, I just pray a whole lot of people are getting these videos and studying them. And but I do know something about value that many artists, Rembrandt, some of those famous artists, their work didn't become valuable until they died. So, you know, a lot of people may not see the value in word outreach right now, but it will. It is a value right now. And many people will see it later on. But if you could grab a hold of it right now, you would really be blessed and bless a whole lot of other people that is sorrowing in the world. Because these videos is not to lift up a woman in the pulpit. It's only to lift up the truth and Jesus Christ. And these messages is given to save somebody's life. Hallelujah. 1 Peter 1 and 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Christ Jesus from the dead. Begotten us. Begotten means to make you born. The first begotten was your mother and father, but we're begotten again through God. Amen. Unto a lively hope. So you have to be born from above to be seated from above. So let's go to Ephesians 2, to be seated from above. See, this is what we're talking about, a whole another thing that people who mock and scoff at the cross, and even a whole lot of Christians, don't realize what went on at that cross. They don't understand what they got. Everywhere I go, Jesus is mine. Ephesians 2, 4 through 9. Ephesians 2, 4 through 9. I'm going to give you another few seconds to get there. Ephesians 2. Now we're talking about you have to be born from above, to be seated from above, to have a perspective from above, a perspective. Ephesians 2, 4 through 9. But God, who is rich in mercy for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we was dead in sins, has quickened us, that means made us alive, us a new birth, together with Christ, by grace you are saved, and has raised us up together and made us sit in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come, I'm talking about from the day that you were born again, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us. He is so kind. Most Christians don't even know the Lord. He's meek and mild and kind. He's such a wonderful God toward us through Christ Jesus. Verse 8, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that is not of yourself. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. It ain't what you done, is nothing but the blood. It's what the blood accomplished on that cross. Nothing, because human beings, see, God knew human beings. Anybody that can live long enough on this earth know human beings. Human beings is some proud beings. If it was left up to them, they would say, I got myself born again. And they do say that out there, lifting up Muhammad, lifting up a Buddha, lifting up whoever. Can't no man save you. You can't even save yourself. It's nothing but the blood. That's what we need to get on these communion Sundays. Lessons about that cross and what was accomplished on it. Everything you got, everything you gonna get. Look what it says here. It says here that verse 8, are you saved through faith? What is faith? Just believe in God. Stop acting foolishness and thinking that the cross is foolishness. The cross ain't foolishness. It is the power of God. Hallelujah. If you're going to be born again, if you're going to heaven, it's going to be by that cross, and it's going to be by that blood. It ain't going to be by nothing else. You're going to find yourself in hell, bow on your knees, and call on Jesus Lord and Lord and say, ooh, Lord, what they said was real. What the fanatic said was real. You better know it. It's going to be real then, just like it's real right now. And somebody is here trying to tell you the truth. Hallelujah. Don't lift up no man. Don't lift up no woman. It's nothing but the blood of Jesus that makes you pure as snow. What man's blood gonna make you pure as snow? You name one. You can't name one man that can make you pure as snow. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Verse 8, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourself. Even that you got to get from God. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. We got people out there boasting about this man and that religion. Stop boasting. Not a man on earth could save you. Let's go to first. So you have to be born from above to be seated from above. I just showed you where you're seated in heavenly places to have a perspective from above. Go to 1 Corinthians 1. To get a perspective from above. See, because we're talking right now in this Bible study on Communion Sunday, we're talking about a perspective that is from above. See, my perspective used to be from below. I got a whole different perspective now. I'm born again and I'm seated from above, and my perspective is coming from above. So when we preach the cross to those that are perishing, it's foolishness. Because their perspective is on the other. Their eyes are not open. We pray for your eyes to be open. Hallelujah. 1 Corinthians 3, and I'm going to read 1 through 10. And so you, in order to have a perspective from above, I'm going to show you, we're going to get a little bit into what next Sunday is showing. We're going to get back to the five stages of Christian growth and development, and we're going to go to that mature stage. But here are people that don't have a perspective from above, and they're brethren. They don't understand the cross. They don't understand what the blood of Jesus did. So, and here it says, and our brethren could not speak unto you as spiritual, but as unto carnal, even as unto babes in Christ. I have fed you with milk and not with meat, for hitherto you are not able to bear it, neither yet are you able, for ye are yet carnal. For whereas there is among you, talking about Christian, envy and strife and divisions, are you not carnal and walk as men? For while one says, I am of Paul, and another, I am of Apollos, are you not carnal? Do you know that the church of God, God's church, is out there comparing human beings to human beings? The church is consuming fire. Over here, we the ones over there. We the ones. If you ain't with us, you ain't, you know. Do you know that that's carnality? And your perspective, dear Christians, is not from above. Your perspective, as long as you are comparing one another, your perspective is from beneath. Let me read again. You have to be born from above, to be seated from above, to have a perspective from above. So verse 4, for while one says, I am of Paul, and another, I am of Apollos, are you not carnal? Who then is Paul, and who is Apollos? But ministers by whom you believe, even as the Lord gave to every man. I have planted, Apollos watered, but it was God who gave the increase. So then neither is he that planted anything, neither he that watered anything, but God that gives the increase. It's all about the blood. Amen. None of us would be here without the blood. Now he that planted and he that watered are one, and every man shall receive his own reward according to his own labor. I wish people would allow me, I'm talking about Doris Arell, the Spirit of God lead me. Don't be trying to lead me and tell me where I'm supposed to be. God is leading me. And I pray to God that he's leading you. The harvest is plenteous. Stop talking about you're the ones. And if you ain't with us, then you ain't, you need to, because you're carnal. The word says that you're carnal and your perspective is not from above. Verse 9, for we are laborers together with God. You are God's husbandry. You are God's building, according to the grace of God, which is given unto me as a wise master builder. I have laid the foundation, and another builders thereon. But let every man take heed how he builds. And I'm going to go down to verse 11. For no other foundation, none can man lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Not your ministry, not your name, not your title, but Jesus Christ and his blood and nothing but the blood. So we're going back to PowerPoint. Yeah, we're going to lift up the cross. We're going to lift up who need to be lifted up. Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. And nothing but the blood. You can't be saved by nothing else but that blood. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Let me go over here. And neither is there salvation in any other name. There is no other name under heaven. You can praise him, given among men, whereby we must be saved. You tell me. Some of y'all tell me. Which man you lifting up, whose blood can make you pure and slow? Tell me now. None. Ain't a man on earth. Nothing but the blood of Jesus Christ. You can find that in Acts 4 and 12. No other name given among men whereby we must be saved. It literally took our God. It literally took our creator to come down from heaven to rescue us. That's what Ecclesiastes 12 and 1 says. Remember your creator, your maker. That first scripture, the opening scripture. Your maker. Your Ecclesiastes 12 and 1 says your creator, John 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word, let's go there to John 1, 1 through 18, let's go and see, because we're talking about God, y'all. God Almighty came down from heaven, and they want to lift up Mohammed, and want to lift up Buddha, and want to lift up Hare Krishna, and want to lift up this, that, and the other. Ain't that a shame? Oh, you know why? Because you don't understand the cross. You don't understand that it took God himself to come down here. No man was worthy. Why would God come down here if Muhammad could do it? Why would God come down here if Buddha could do it? Nothing but the blood of Jesus Christ. John 1, 1 through 18. In the beginning was the Word. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him. And without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. There was a man sent from God whose name was John, John the Baptist. The same came for a witness to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. John was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light. That light is every man that comes into the world, your maker. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came into his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word, which was in the beginning and was God, was made flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory, the glory as the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. John bare witness of him and cried, saying, this was he of whom I spoke. He that cometh after me is preferred before me, for he was before me. And of his fullness have we received, and grace for grace. For the law was given by another great man, Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. No man, including Moses, Muhammad, Hare Krishna, has seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which was in the bosom of the Father, he had declared him. Nothing but the blood. It was God himself that had to come rescue us. And they want to compare him to another man. No other name given amongst men, no other name and no other blood. Now, I want you, when you seriously consider the blood of Jesus Christ and what it accomplished, you can't help but be amazed. The Bible says, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. You think Muhammad can make you a new creature? What? A mere man? We're not talking about a mere man. We're talking about God. In the beginning was the Word was God, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Amen. So old things, we're talking about Old Testament things, them 7,426 rituals trying to consecrate people, that's passed away. That was just a shadow of things to come. And all things have become new. When they've offered all of these sacrifices, and Jesus Christ came and did one single act replaced 7,426 ritual washings. Now, I have this video here is out in the fullness. It's already out. It came out a couple of days ago in the fullness where I preach about all this. But I just want to go to Leviticus 14 to show you a little bit of one of those 7,426 ritual washing, just one of them. Because when I got to reading how they cleansed the lepers, I wasn't about to read the other 7,425. Just one. I want you to see how complex it was in the Old Testament, what they did and for consecrations and sin and all that. I'm gonna read it really fast because we got to get to our communion. But just put yourself there. You're a leper, you come to get cleansed. I'm just gonna read part of this because it goes on and on and on. Leviticus 14, 1. And the Lord spake unto Moses saying, this shall be the law of the leper in the day of his cleansing. He shall be brought unto the priest, and the priest shall go forth out of the camp, and the priest shall look and behold if the plague of leprosy be healed in the leper. Then shall the priest command to take for him that is to be cleansed two birds alive and clean, and cedar wood, and scarlet, and hyssop. And the priest shall command that one of the birds be killed in an earthen vessel over running water. As for the living bird, he shall take it and the cedar wood and the scarlet and the hyssop and shall dip them and the living bird in the blood of the bird that was killed over the running water. And he shall sprinkle upon him that is to be clean from the leprosy seven times and shall pronounce him clean and shall let the living bird loose into the open field. And he that is to be cleansed shall wash his clothes and shave off all his hair and wash himself in water, that he may be clean. And after that, he shall come into the camp and shall tarry abroad out of his tent 7 days. But it shall be on the seventh day that he shall shave off his hair off his head and his beard and his eyebrows, even all his hair he shall shave off. And he shall wash his clothes. Also, he shall wash his flesh in water and he shall be clean. And on the eighth day, he shall take two he lambs without blemish and one ewe lamb of the first year without blemish, and 3/10 deal of fine flour for a meat offering, mingled with oil, and one log of oil. And the priest that maketh him clean shall present the man that is to be made clean and those things before the Lord at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. And the priest shall take one he lamb and offer him for a trespass offering, and the log of oil, and wave them for a wave offering before the Lord. And he shall slay the lamb in the place where he shall kill the sin offering and the burnt offering in the holy place. For as the sin offering is the priest, so is the trespass offering. It is most holy. And the priest shall take some of the blood of the trespass offering, and the priest shall put it upon the tip of the right ear of him that is to be cleansed, and upon the right thumb of his right hand, and upon the great toe of his right foot. And the priest shall take some of the log of oil and pour it upon the palm of his own left hand. And the priest shall dip his right finger in the oil that is in his left hand and shall sprinkle of the oil with his finger 7 times before the Lord. And the rest of the oil that is in his hand shall the priest put upon the tip of the right ear of him that is to be cleansed and upon the thumb of his right hand and upon the great toe of his right foot, upon the blood of the trespassing offering, and the remnant of the oil that is in the priest's hand, he shall pour upon the head of him that is to be cleansed, and the priest shall make an atonement of him before the Lord. Now, I'm not going to verse 32. I did go to verse 32 in the video that I put out 2 days ago. But what I want you to see is going through all of that, all that ritualistic cleansing, which can never take away your sin. Well, Jesus Christ, with one sacrifice, one single sacrifice, did what they could not do. He cleansed the heart of man. And so this one man, after he offered one sacrifice for sin forever, sat down on the right hand of God. And I'm going to stop right here. Amen. And I'm going to tell you, nothing but the blood of Jesus. All those 7,426 ritualistic washings was a foreshadow, waiting on Jesus to come and make that one sacrifice. One sacrifice. Now you tell me again, what man do you know, or you done read about in history, what man's blood can do that? Nothing. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. So, oh yeah, the preaching of the cross to them that are perished is straight out foolishness, because your perspective is from beneath. But to us that are saved, it is the very power of God. We're going to get one more song to get us ready for communion, and we're going to thank God for his blood. We're going to remember what he did through Holy Communion in Jesus' mighty name. I ain't lifting up no man. I'm going to tell you, I'm going to tell all of y'all. You might as well hear it from my mouth. I'm not lifting up no man. I'm not going to lift up no church, no religion. All I'm going to ever lift up is Jesus Christ and him crucified. So just go on and get that straight right now. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. So get me out the mix with your mess. Thank you, Lord God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Nothing. Jesus.
Body, his blood, know that he has overcome. Leads to come.